Hello, everybody. I'm a computer scientist. In particular, I am an artificial intelligence researcher. So I am, you can think of me as a geek. So you might think, oh, what is this geek I'm going to talk about and how it relates to art? So as a scientist, I believe that if everything in the universe is governed by laws, art history must be as well. These are not my words. This is a quote from Colin Martindale, who was a professor of psychology at University of Maine. From his book that I consider a great book, The Clockwork Muse, Predictability of Artistic Change. So can AI be creative? For me as an AI researcher, that's a big challenge because I believe, totally believe that understanding and generating human level creative products such as paintings, music, sculpture, jokes, stories, are fundamental to prove that artificial intelligence is really intelligent. So for me, it's a big challenge. How can we make the machine be creative? First, we have to teach the machine how to be creative. What is creativity? But then that means that we have to define what is creativity. We have to come up with a definition of creativity. So what was it about Picasso, Young Ladies of Avignon, or Munch, The Scream? What was it about this painting that captivated the audience? Whenever somebody sees this, they like them. And they marked themselves, they cemented themselves in the canon of art history as masterpieces, as iconic works of art. What was it about them? So it was always the case that artist has used some novel technique, form, or style that never existed before. And artists, for years to come, would mimic this new style or new form. Can we have the machine look at art history and learn by itself what is innovative changes, what is creative about art history? Expert art history experts always tell us what was the innovative things in art history, but can the machine do that? And why we need to do that? Because for at some point, the machine has to become creative, and for that to happen, the machine has to judge its own creativity. The machine should be able to create something and judge whether that's creative or not. So how can we define creativity to start with? There is a long and ongoing debate about what is creativity. We can associate creativity to a person. You can say Andy Warhol was a creative artist, or Mozart was a creative artist. Or you can associate creativity with a product. You can say the Mona Lisa as an artwork is a creative artwork. Or you can think of the mental process of creating something as creative process. So we go to the basic definition of creativity, which involves two elements, two important elements. Originality, something has to be original, novel, compared to what happened before it. But that's not enough. It has to be influential. If you do something novel nobody cares about, that's not creative. Because influence means that people really care about what you did and start to copy it and mimic it, and that's a fundamental part of what creativity is. So this definition resonates with the philosophical definition of creativity that goes back to Kant, Immanuel Kant from the 18th century, who defined what's called artistic genius. And in his definition, there are two elements, being original and being exemplary influence. So how can we teach a machine about creativity? How can we drive an algorithm for creativity? Can you think with me? So let's have all the art that we have, images of all the art we have, and let's define an algorithm for creativity. Let's think about that. So let's break it down to the basic element. Let's compare two artworks at a time. So what if you compare these two artworks, one by Caravaggio from 1600 and one by a little less known artist in 1800? If you look at them side by side, you realize that the later artwork is somehow derivative of the first. Have the same composition, same lighting, same body pose. So it must be a derivative. If you just look at these two artworks and you give a score for both of them, you must increase the score for Caravaggio because that artwork was influential in a direct or indirect way. And the later artwork was less creative because it's a derivative. Now let's consider another example. Here we have a Sicily impressionist work and a Picasso later work. Comparing them side by side, you realize that Picasso in his work didn't really, was not influenced much by Sicily's work. He was novel and created something new. So if you just compare these two artworks side by side, you can increase the creativity of this Picasso's work and decrease the creativity of that Sicily work in terms of influence on Picasso. So now imagine you're doing that for all possible pairs of artwork. So you have a big network of artworks. And in fact, you actually can write a formula. That's what geeks do. We write formula for everything. So we write a formula to compute creativity of every artwork. So what we are actually doing here is that through mathematical derivation, we actually reduce this problem to a very known problem, which is called network centrality. These are problems that are used in finding social interaction, understanding epidemics, and even every day you are using it when you're searching the web. So you search Google, and Google uses an algorithm called PageRank, and PageRank is nothing other than a network centrality algorithm. So, but forget about the equation. What are we doing here? We've given the machine images of artwork, and no knowledge about art history. No social context, no historical context, nothing about religion, nothing about wars, nothing about who is famous artist and who is not famous artist, only images and the date, the timestamp, nothing else. And look at the visual form, the element of art, and tell me who was innovative and who was influential. So let's look at some results. We looked at several sets of images. Here it's set from 1400 to 2000, 1700 artworks. All are masterworks, masterpieces. So all of them are creative, definitely. But the way we formulated the problem, it's a zero-sum game. So for somebody to create a high score, another has to score low. It's a zero-sum game. So at the horizontal axis, the x-axis, you see the time. And the vertical axis, you see the creativity score. And every artwork is just a point in that graph. Every point is an artwork. Now, a couple of disclaimers. I am not an art historian. I'm not making any claims about art history. I remind you, I'm a geek. I'm just making comments about what the machine finds when we give it this definition of creativity and let it look at the art. So what the machine sees here. So you can see it gives high score to some Vermeers and Montaigne from Renaissance. But let's look at the 19th century. You figure out that the machine actually likes Tuvis work very much in 19th century. In particular, Monet haystacks from 1865. That's actually very interesting because this haystack painting by Monet came 5 years even before Impressionism becomes an art movement. And that's 25 years before his famous haystack series. So the machine figured itself that something very novel about this that was very influential moving forward. Not only this, the machine also gave a very high score to Munch the Scream. Again, very famous, influential expressionist artwork. Actually, that was one of the most copied artwork in the 20th century. The machine, again, find that by itself, find out that this has been influential, this has been very novel its time. And if you zoom in to the basically the first decade of 20th century, you find that actually the machine did a very good job looking at art and figuring out what's happening. So you can see it give a high score to Klimt's poster, very high score to Picasso's Blue Period paintings. But if you look at the first decade of the 20th century, something very interesting. You see this dot here is actually Picasso's Young Ladies Avignon again. So the machine gave it the highest score in the first decade of the 20th century. And if you talk to art historians, they will tell you this piece is the precursor of cubism. So this is the first time Picasso actually experimenting with cubism in a very primitive way and threatening the picture plane and using primitivism and things like that. And you see that this only topped in 1912 by actually cubism itself. So you can see in 1912, everything having high score is Picasso and Braque, and the machine finding this as the most creative thing at that time. More interesting, in 1915, the machine actually figured out that Malevich, Kazimir Malevich, the Russian artist, in his what's called suprematism style, is actually topping cubism. It's getting something new here, minimalism and very abstract art. So again, the machine finding all that by itself. So many interesting things you can find here. In the 20s and 30s of 20th centuries, the machine basically preferred Mondrian and Okafi. But what is this point? There's a point in the chart here that of the chart in 1910. What is this point? When we look at this, we found that this is an artwork by Mondrian that was dated 1910. When I looked carefully, I find something very interesting. Mondrian didn't do this work in 1910. He did it in 1930-something. So the algorithm was given wrong data, wrong date. This was done 1930. The algorithm was given 1910. And that's why the algorithm gave it a very high score. So algorithm is telling us if Mondrian would have done this in 19, then he must have been the most creative artist in his time. Well, for me, that's good news. The algorithm works. The algorithm is making something that makes sense. This actually gave me a very good idea of how to actually validate this algorithm. It's very hard to validate such thing. So this is what I called our time machine. Imagine that you have your artworks, and you start manipulating the dates of the artworks. So you take an artwork from Renaissance and change its date to, let's say, 20th century. What will you expect if the algorithm actually works? Its creativity score should go down, because it is not novel anymore to do Renaissance at 20th century. At the same time, if you take an artwork from 20th century or 19th century and push it back to 1600, its creativity score should go up, because it should be ahead of its time. It should be way ahead of its time. That's exactly what we did. So we would pick up a small bunch of artwork, manipulate their dates, like take Impressionist work, put them back to 1600. They have basically 15% increase in creativity. Take Expressionism work, put them back to 1600. They increase 17% in their creativity. Take Neoclassicism, push them back to Renaissance time. They only have 5% increase in creativity. Why is that? Neoclassicism is basically a reinvention of Renaissance. In the same time, if you take Renaissance work, put it to the 20th century, you get basically decrease in their creativity, 8%. Take Baroque, move them forward, 10% decrease. So that tells us that the algorithm makes some sense. It's doing something sensible. All right, so now, does the algorithm always give us something that we agrees on, or the art historian agrees on? Not necessarily. For example, out of Da Vinci's work, the algorithm give a very high score to that art at the right of the screen, which is St. John the Baptist, and in fact, didn't like the Mona Lisa. The algorithm didn't figure out what is about the Mona Lisa that's so creative. Anyway, that's how the machine look at things. All right, so now the machine have some sense of what creativity is and can make sense of things based on the visual element. Now it comes back to the question, can the machine become creative? Can the machine actually make art? So how can we do that? So I'm going to talk about what we call a creative adversarial network, CAN, creative adversarial network. What is that? We're trying to create art using the machine. How? If you give the machine lots and lots of artworks, all you can get from art history, can the machine look at that and give you art? Well, a typical machine learning or artificial intelligence algorithm will just look at that and emulate art. We'll just try to do things like what it sees. However, this is not art. It's just emulate art. This is not art. Art has to be novel. So that's exactly what happened here. When you give it all this classical artwork, it starts to try to generate portraits, landscapes, battlefields, and most of cases, there are failed attempts to make this even happening. That's what happened. The machine is trying to emulate art. How can you make the machine create novel art? So how to move from being emulative to being innovative? So that actually led us to the question, which is how art is being created. Let's think of this scenario here. Artists making art, like impressionist art, again and again and again. At some point, as a viewer, as an artist yourself, you become bored of this. That's what's called habituation. You want something new, otherwise you get bored. So artists always try to innovate in their work. However, innovation has to be constrained, because too much innovation will lead to your aversion system of your brain kicking in and not liking what you see. So the great artists are the ones who really find the sweet spot between being innovative but not being too innovative. This is a basic theory from psychology that we based our work on. So basically, what we did in developing this creative adversarial network is this concept. How can you have these two opposing forces? One force that seek innovation and one force that constrain that innovation. How can we do that? We give the machine all these artworks. We train the machine to know about styles, Renaissance, Baroque, Impressionism, Cubism. It knows about that. But now it has to give us something new, follow that aesthetics, but it doesn't follow any styles. If it starts giving us new Impressionism or new Cubism, it gets banalized. So the machine has to learn now to find a solution, a new artwork that follows the aesthetics but doesn't follow styles, break out of styles. As a result, the machine started getting us very interesting works. So here are some of the artworks that the machine actually generates. you see basically different compositions, interesting composition, interesting choices of color. Everything here is done by the machine, no human intervention. Nobody chooses the color, nobody chooses the composition. The machine is just keep generating based on what it sees and based on the formulation that we have done. You can see that the machine chooses warm colors versus cold colors, foreground and background, contrast, all these things, learn the aesthetics and trying to generate always new composition, new artwork. So lots of artworks the machine keep generating. Is that art? What is the people reaction to this? So we conducted human subject experiments where we show people these artworks mixed up with actual human art. For the actual human art, we choose art by abstract expressionist masters, because these are people might be familiar with them, so this is a baseline, but also art from Art Basel Art Fair in 2016. Art Basel is the flagship contemporary art fair. So that's basically the flagship of human creativity in terms of art. And we mix them together and ask the question, is this art done by a human or a machine? This was called Turing test, a visual Turing test. And other questions as well. To our surprise, a human subject thought that the machine art was done by a human 75% of the time, compared to 85% of the time for the art from the abstract expressionist collection, and only 48% of the time for the art from the Art Basel collection. You would think of Art Basel art as done by the machine. So what that tells us is that people, in general, cannot tell whether the art is done by the machine and or done by human. Moreover, human give attributes like intentional, having visual structure, communicational, inspirational, to artworks done by the machine at the same level, even higher than the art done by the machine. If the human see art as intentional and as inspiring and communicational, then I call it art. You might not agree with me, but I call it art. All right, so I quote Picasso here, who said, I discovered photography, I can now kill myself, I have nothing else to learn. I believe that AI art is first time since the invention of photography that provide a technology that can change what art is and what art is made and even the definition of art. I believe the machine now is at a point where it can be creative, it can choose its own color, its own composition and keep generating art. Artificial intelligent art is here. However, that raises many questions. What that tells us about what art is? What is the definition of art? Definition of art is something that's always changing, so how it will change now? Who is the artist here? Should I be the artist who because I programmed the machine to do that? Am I a geek or an artist? I don't know. How that will change art and the way art made in the future? All these are open questions. Thank you very much.